Good morning. Today, we are going to learn the remaining topic about the legal procedure. Till today's lecture, we have covered two lectures in that the basic thing about the forensic medicine in first lecture, second lecture, different type of cases, different types of offenses, different type of witnesses, different types of court. Now, this is my third lecture on a court procedure. So at first, we'll revise what has been taken up till now. So we are dealing with a legal procedure topic. In first lecture, we have learned about the Criminal Procedure Code, Indian Penal Code, Civil Procedure Code, and what is meant by Indian Evidence Act. Afterwards, we have learned about different types of inquest, police inquest, magistrate inquest, coroner's inquest, medical exam system of inquiry. Again, I am repeating that in India, only two types of the inquest is carried out, that is police inquest and magistrate inquest. Police inquest by 174 CRPC, while magistrate inquest by 176 CRPC. And in police inquest, panchanama is done. So in a theory, the short note come on police inquest or a magistrate inquest. While all over the world, these four types of the inquest, that is police inquest, magistrate inquest, coroner's inquest, and medical exam system of the inquiry is carried out. And the best method is medical examination system of the inquiry, because here there is team of doctor, team of forensic expert, team of police, and the that of the other fingerprint expert or other expert are there. So when there is teamwork, the result is more success. Then there are two types of offenses, cognizable offenses, non-cognizable offenses. Then criminal cases, cognizable, non-cognizable, warrant case, summons case, police case, complaint case, and civil cases. Then different types of the court, that is Supreme Court, High Court, Session Court, Chief Judicial Magistrate Court, Judicial Magistrate of First Class, Judicial Second Class Judicial Magistrate, and Court of Juvenile Magistrate. Now, I will start the important thing of today's lecture, that is about the evidences. So you all know what is the importance of the evidence. Importance of the evidence is that evidence is required for the proper justice. If the proper evidence is produced in a court through proper chain of custody, and if it is accepted by the court, then and then only the correct justice can be given. So evidence is very important. In Hindi, that the bina sabut nyay nahi milta. So sabut is very important. What means by sabut? That is the evidence. What are broad types of the evidences? That is oral evidence and the documentary evidence. The important always, any evidence which is documented, that is very important. But still, if you submit that documentary evidence in a court, still you have to go to the court and give orally that this evidence is submitted by you, and whatever the question on the that evidence, court is going to ask. So these are very important, that is oral and documentary. As a doctor, as a medical practitioner, you have to always take a documentary evidence. Because oral evidence, you cannot, if you have recording is there, then it is accepted. While afterwards, it doesn't have any value. So always take any consent or your IPD paper, OPD paper, these are the documentary evidences. So documentary evidences are very important. Then what are types of the documentary evidences? These are the different types of the documentary evidences. You can see on the slide, that is primary, secondary, material evidence, direct evidence, indirect evidence, circumstantial evidence, hearsay evidence, prima facie evidence, proved disproved and non-proved. One by one, we will see in details what is meaning by the primary evidence. Primary evidence are the original papers produced in a court. Whatever the original IPD paper, original OPD paper, original notary, or original sale deed, all these are the primary evidences. Then what are secondary evidence? Secondary evidences are the photocopy or xerox copy or duplicate of that original evidence, that is known as the secondary evidence. So the primary evidence is the original, while secondary evidence is the, you have to produce the photocopy or xerox copy of the primary evidence. Then material evidence means any material produced in a court, that is material evidence. Related to my subject, that is if there is murder and the weapon is produced, that weapon consists of the material evidence, or any swab in case of the rape case, genital swab, swab from the breast, that is material evidence. So all these evidences, when proper chain of the custody is there, these type of the evidences are known as the material type of the evidence. Direct evidence. What do you mean by the word direct evidence? Direct evidence is the evidence when a person tells that he has directly seen that thing. What has happened? So that is the direct evidence. Indirect evidence means is not directly related to that thing. So that is the indirect evidence. Means he is not directly related to that thing, but some other evidence which gives some clue about the direct evidence is known as the indirect evidence. Circumstantial evidence means at that circumstances, anything is found. If there is murder and there is the that person tries to escape from this, so that area gets the improperly distributed, that the all these clothes or other things, if he is in home, all are scattered here and there, or there are the blood stains are there on the floor, or if the clothes are torn. So that is the circumstances suggest. So that is the circumstantial evidences which is found at that scene of crime. That is circumstantial. Hearsay evidence. Hearsay evidence means that the third person has heard what the two persons have seen. So he has not directly seen that, like in a direct evidence. But what he heard that these two persons were talking like this and this person has murdered. He only said, that is the hearsay evidence. But it does not have that much value as that of the direct evidence. So that is the hearsay evidence. Means he has heard that thing. But he has not actually seen, or he has not actually witnessed that thing. He has heard from other things, that is known as a hearsay. Then prima facie. Prima facie means the what is the from that instant, what you get the idea, that is the prima facie evidence. Proved evidence means in a court, after considering all the facts, the court has something has been proved, that is known as proved evidence. Disproved evidence, that after considering all the things, court has disproved something, that is known as a disproved evidence. And not proved means it is, even after court, it is not eitherly not proved or not disproved. That is not proved evidence. So these are the types of the different evidences. Is it clear? Clear about the different types of the evidences? So there are two types, that is oral and documentary. The example are the primary evidence, secondary evidence, material evidence, direct evidence, indirect evidence, circumstantial evidence, hearsay evidence, prima facie evidence, proved evidence, disproved evidence, and not proved evidence. Then what do you, this is the viva question. What is meaning of the corpus delicti? Corpus delicti means a dead body finding on which or appearance of which suggests that some illegal act has occurred relating to the death of the person, that is known as the corpus delicti. Again, I am repeating, this is very important thing and usually asked in a viva. What do you understood by the word corpus delicti? So, corpus delicti means a dead body finding on which or appearance of the which suggests that some illegal act has occurred which is relating to the death of the person. That is known as the corpus delict. Then we'll come, we have seen in the last slide what are different types of the evidences, that is the oral and documentary. Now in details we are going to see the documentary evidence related to the medical practice. So these are the four important documentary evidences, that is medical certificates, medico-legal reports, dying declaration and dying deposition. On each, short note has come in a university examination. So in broad, in last slide, we have seen the documentary evidences, that is primary, secondary, material, direct, indirect, etc., etc. Now, in this, we are going to learn in detail about the important documentary evidences related to the medical practice. First, we will consider what is basic difference between the medical certificate and medico-legal report. Example, upper medical certificate is the sickness certificate, fitness certificate, birth certificate, death certificate. An example of the medico-legal report is injury, postmortem, sexual offenses, age estimation, etc., etc. So what is the basic difference between the certificate and the report? The first and foremost basic difference between the certificate and report is that certificate is always issued on the request of the patient, while reports are always issued on a request of the authority, either police or either court. So that is the basic difference. So again, I'm repeating, medical certificates are issued after the request of the patient, while medico-legal reports are issued after the request of the authority, that is police or lawyer or judge. So these are the authority. Who are the authority? Magistrate, police or judge, these are the authority on which request you are going to issue the reports. Second basic thing, medical certificate only considers the name, age, sex, what disease here, and identification mark, and afterwards your signature. So that is the single one page pro forma of the medical certificate. While medico-legal report consists of first part, it is considering of the three parts. First part, general information about that patient. Second part, your observation. Your, what are the signs, what are the symptoms, what you have examined, what investigation you have done. And the third part, your opinion. So after considering your general information, after considering your observation, that is signs, symptoms, investigation, and after that, your observation, after that, you are issuing the certificate, opinion. So that are the three parts medico-legal report. So the medical certificate consists of only one page, and the while that of the medico-legal report has the three parts, that is the general information, your second part is your observation, and third part is observation. So that the medico-legal report. So again, I'm repeating, two basic differences are between the medical certificate and medico-legal report. Medical certificate are always issued on a request of the patient, while medico-legal reports are issued on after the request of the authority, that is police, judge, or magistrate. And second difference, medical certificate are one page certificates, while medico-legal report consists of three parts. First part, general information about the patient, that or that of victim or accused. Second part is the your observation, and the third part is your opinion. Is it clear up till now? What is medical certificate? What is medico-legal report? Third is known as the dying declaration, and fourth is known as a dying deposition. So dying declaration is very important. What is the meaning of the dying declaration? Dying declaration is a statement given by a person who is going to die related to his condition which is leading to his death. So what is dying declaration? Dying declaration is a statement. Statement by whom given? A person who is going to die. Now what he is telling? That he is telling the circumstances or what has happened with him or her, which is leading to his or her death. So that is the dying declaration. So dying declaration is a statement given by a person who is going to die related to his condition, which is leading to his or her death. That is dying declaration. Ideally, dying declaration must be carried out by the magistrate. If the person is admitted in your hospital, in ICU, in that condition, if you want to give the dying declaration, then you have to inform to the magistrate. And usually, this dying declaration must be written by a police in presence of two witnesses and in presence of doctor. What is the role of doctor? Role of a doctor in a dying declaration is that first role, that he has to give the certificate that the person who is giving dying declaration is in compos mentis. What is compos mentis? Means he is in a sound mind, or he or she is the sound mind. He is oriented to person, place, time. So that certificate is given by a doctor. That person is oriented to time, place, person. And he is in compos mentis. That is the first duty of the doctor. But if you feel that there is time to come the magistrate at your hospital or at your in your ICU, and patient may die till the magistrate come, in that condition, what you have to do, that as you can itself, doctor can take the dying declaration. But first reference must be given to the magistrate. But if you feel that the till the magistrate come to your hospital, patient may die. In that condition, you yourself can take a dying declaration. Again, I am repeating, dying declaration must be taken in patient's handwriting. But if the patient condition is not, or patient is illiterate, in that case, you yourself write what the patient is telling, and in presence of two witness and near relative must be there. Afterwards, you can, whatever you are written, you have to read in front of the patient, and afterward take a thumb impression of the patient, or if he is literate, take the signature of the patient in presence of two witnesses. So that the procedure, how the dying declaration is taken. And even if the, and usually police should be avoided to take the dying declaration. If the person is at a remote place, at a village place, that sarpanch can take a dying declaration, but it does not have that value. So again, I'm repeating, ideally, dying declaration must be done by the magistrate. If the person is in a hospital and you feel that till the magistrate come, patient may die, in that case, doctor can take a dying declaration. But second duty of a doctor is to give certificate that the person who is giving dying declaration, he is in a compos mentis, that is of a sound mind and oriented to time, place, person. So these are the two duties of the doctor. Then if the person is illiterate, then the doctor can itself write that. Ideally, patient must write in his own handwriting. But if the person is not, his condition is such a like that he is not able to write, or he or she is illiterate, in that case, doctor can write that dying declaration in presence of near relative and two witnesses. And afterwards, whatever he has written, doctor has written, should be read in front of the patient and take the thumb impression, or he is literate, take the signature of two witnesses, that the dying declaration. If the person is not able to speak also, then with gestures and asking the question, dying declaration can be done. Nowadays, all have mobile, so video recording of that gesture also can be taken. So that is the method of taking the dying declaration. What is the importance of the dying declaration? Importance of the dying declaration is that the law presumes, or court presumes, that the person who is going to die never tells lie. means he always speak the truth. That's the important thing about the dying declaration. So that the court presumes that person who is going to die is always speak the truth. So that's the importance of the dying declaration. But if the person survives with your treatment, then this dying declaration doesn't have that value. It has only the corroborative value. If patient dies, then it has that value. Important thing, because what court presumes? Court presumes that the patient who is going to die or person who is going to die never tells the lie. He always speaks the truth. But if the patient survives, then it has only corroborative evidence. So that's the importance of the dying declaration. Is it clear? So short note comes on a dying declaration. So you have to write whatever I have think. So who is the ideal person? Magistrate. If magistrate, time is there to come, doctor can take. Ideally, in a patient's own handwriting. But if the patient is illiterate or his condition is so severe, he or she is not able to write, then doctor can take in presence of relative two witness. Afterwards, he has to read what he has written, take the signature or the thumb impression of the patient in presence of two witnesses. What is the duty of another duty of doctor? Give a certificate of composement is that patient is of a sound mind, read that of the and oriented to time, place, person. That the second thing of the dying declaration, important thing of a duty of a doctor, then it has much more value in a court, because court presumes that the person who is going to die is always speak the truth. And if the patient survives or person survives, it doesn't have that much value. It has some value in a court, that is corroborative. So that's all about the dying declaration. Next is dying deposition. What is the difference between dying deposition? Dying deposition is always taken on oath. For dying deposition, always magistrate is required. Third thing, accused or his lawyer can be present at the time of the dying deposition. So these are the conditions of the dying deposition. What are the difference? Method is same, but dying declaration can be taken by a doctor. Here, magistrate must be required for the dying deposition. What is the second thing? Second thing, it is always taken on oath. What is the third important difference? That is accused or his lawyer is present. So these are the things about the dying deposition. So dying declaration and dying deposition. So medical certificates, medical legal reports, then there is dying declaration, then there is the dying deposition. I think with this elaborative discussion, your concept about dying declaration and dying deposition are cleared. So that is the dying declaration. What is dying declaration and I have dying deposition? Which is superior? What do you think? It's obvious that the dying deposition is superior. Why? Because oath is there. Magistrate takes it. Still doctor has a role. Why? He has to give the certificate of composement. It means doctor is required in dying declaration as well as dying deposition. And accused or his lawyer is present. So all these things are present. So the dying deposition has much more value as compared to that of the dying declaration. Again, same thing. If the person survives, it doesn't have too much value, only the corroborative value. So that is about the documentary evidences. Then we'll go to important topic, that is what are the court procedures. So the first we'll go summons. What is summons? Summons is a directive or order issued by the court requiring the presence of the witness in a court on a specific date, specific time to dispose as to what he knows in relation to the case under the trial in a court. So summons is a document compelling a person to attend a court at a particular day, time, place for giving witness in a court of law. So summons is a directive or order issued by the court requiring the presence of the person at a particular date, time to dispose a witness in relation to the case under the trial. In other words, is the document compelling a person to attend a court at particular date time person as a witness to tell the facts related to the case under the trial. So that is the summons. Summons is always issued by court person in a duplicate, or it is given by police to the witness. It is always in duplicate, one copy. You have to whom it is issued, witness, he has to take received on it. One copy remain to the that witness person, and another copy with received my remark that can be again given to the court. So that is the, it is always given in duplicate. If the person is a government servant, actually this summons should be issued personally to the witness. But if he is the government servant, is not present on that day, it can be given to his HOD or head of the institute. Or like in a private also, to his HOD or head of institute. If that person is not in office and he is not, then it can be given to his home, to his near relative, not to the housemaid. Never give it to the housemaid. If the there is lock on the that person, that his house is locked, then it can be stuck on the door. So that the procedure of the summon. If the person get two summons at a one time, then the summon of a, if it is of a criminal court or civil court, so give preference to the criminal court. If it is of a, one is of a high court, one is of a session court, give the preference to the high court, higher court. If both are of a high court, of a same level courts, then the summons which is received early, you have to attend that. But in each case, you have to convey the other court that, so the, he has received two summons, and as it is of a either criminal court or it is of a higher court, or that summons which he or she receives first, so that valid reason must be written or conveyed to the other court that another date he is going to attend. So that the thing about the, if the person receives summon, two summons at a particular date. Again, I am repeating, if it is of a criminal and civil, give preference to the criminal. If it is of high court and session court, give preference to the higher court, that is high court. If it is of the both, that is the both are of high court, which summons you received first, give preference to that. So these are the both things. That is the high court, that the person has to give the preference to the summons which is received first. And important thing, convey to another court. That is the valid reason. He is attending to another court. Because if you are not going to attend, the court can issue a warrant against the witness if he is not attending the or obeying the summons. Again, I am telling, summons case is different and summons is different. Summons case is the case where the punishment is below 2 years, and summons is a document compelling a person to attend a court at a particular day, time, place to give a witness in a court of law. Next important part is the conduct money. Conduct money is the money given for to the witness for attending the court as a traveling expenses. For a doctor, he can get that conduct money, or he can insist conduct money in civil cases. But in a criminal cases, he should not insist. If the court has given the conduct money, traveling expense, it's well and good. If court doesn't have given, he should not insist in a, for the conduct money in a criminal case. Why? Because as a society, you are, we as a doctor also part of the society, and our duty is also to maintain law and order in the society. So for that reason, to maintain a peace in a society, we have to do some sacrifice. So for giving the witness, this can be done. This can be done. So you should, you never insist the summons, you never insist in a court the conduct money. Only in a civil cases you can insist. Then what are the procedures? There is examination in chief. cross-examination, re-examination, question by judge, and release of the witness from the court. First is examination of chief. It is always done by public prosecutor or the lawyer who has called you. And here only general information is noted, or what he has seen, only that general things has been asked in an examination in chief. Cross-examination is very important, and all have phobia, fear in the mind about the cross-examination because it is taken by opposite lawyer. And here that person can ask any question also about your character also. But if it is very disgusting questions are there, then you can see. You can see at the judge. So judge can take the objection, or your lawyer can take if these questions are very irrelevant and disgusting. And leading questions. Leading questions are the questions where the answer is itself in the question, or it is of yes or no type. In examination or in chief, leading questions are never asked. While in cross-examination, leading questions can be asked. For example, you can see, so the what weapon has caused that injury? It's not leading question. If you are showing that knife and with this doctor, can this knife can cause this injury? So that type of the question is the leading question. So knife, that answer is itself in a question. So that type of the questions are the leading questions. And in a cross-examination, the opposite lawyer examines you. But you should be confident. If you are confident, you have a sound knowledge, whatever the things, you know, you have to tell the true things. But don't tell extra thing. Don't talk extra. I'm going to give some hints afterwards. So that's the basic difference. Examination, cross-examination. And what is re-examination? Whatever some issues are raised in a cross-examination, the lawyer who has taken the examination in chief also can do the re-examination. So to clear the doubts or the questions raised in a cross-examination, and re-examination is carried out by the lawyer who has called or a public prosecutor. Then afterwards, any questions which are in the mind of the judge can ask you. And after all these, you can release from the court by you have to take permission from the judge. And after taking permission from the judge, then and then only you can leave the court. So these are the common court procedure. That is, first there is summons. Then what is conduct money, and what when you are entering in the court, you have to be polite, ask the judge, my lord, may I come, like this, then take his permission. Afterward, there is examination in chief by public prosecutor or a lawyer who has called, then cross-examination by opposite lawyer, and it's very, here the critical questions can be asked, and you should be confident about your knowledge. Then here leading questions also can be asked. Then re-examination, again the questions by the public prosecutor who has called, then questions by judges, last by the judge, or if it is the panel of the judges, the judges can ask questions to the witness, and afterwards all the things are there, then you can ask the permission that, my lord, can I leave? Then if that court gives you permission, then you can leave the court. So that's the proper court procedure. Now, as a doctor, I have told you that doctor can be a common witness, doctor can be an expert witness, or it should be or never should be doctor as a hostile witness. So how doctor should represent himself in a court? And these are the points with which you can represent in a court, and you have to maintain dignity of the medical profession, because medical profession is the noble profession and society treats us next to God. So you have to maintain that dignity. And for maintaining that dignity, you should be confident. You should have the sound knowledge. You should prepare well. you have to take some references, you have to read all these things, and with your knowledge, with your confidence, you can give a correct witness. So what are the things? Well, converse with the subject. I have told that read all the things related to the case, see the documents, see the, your signature is there or not, have you given that certificate correctly at that time. All these things you have to do, study about that case. Be confident, and when you are confident, when your concepts are clear. And I think I am again repeating, as am my students, that if you read and if you clear your concept in a second year only, again I'm telling you, never be have the phobia about the attending the court. So be confident, and when you are confident, when your knowledge is sound, if you are well conversant with your subject, you are confident, so that the natural thing comes. Should not fumble. Marathi tata mama vaila nahi paije, then don't exaggerate words, don't insist some words, no it has caused this only, don't you should be unbiased, you should be unbiased, don't use scientific jargon. So there you are going to learn this, the res ipsa locutor is the novus actus intervenus, like this longer this word, because the court, these people are non medical people, they doesn't know all scientific, they depend upon you as a scientific person, as a scientific medical person. Try to tell the organ name in a local language. Don't try to show your knowledge. Stand erect, answer slowly, steadily and loudly. Why? Because there is judge listen, but there is one person who is typing there, so give him time to type all what you are seeing. So you should stand erect, answer slowly, steadily and loudly, that the another person can do the typing well. Answer straightly, whatever you know, straightly. Don't twist, don't tell the stories, go to the point, be specific. I'm telling in my lecture, it's the legal, my subject is related to legal, be specific, point to point. So obey that, should not go beyond the knowledge. If you don't know, accept it, and there is no sin. Or if you don't know, because knowledge is too vast, it's not possible for every person have known to each and everything of the world. It's not possible for a single person. So if you don't know, you can ask, yes, I have not read, but I will read it and then I will comment it. Sometimes what happens, that lawyer can show you some book or some paragraph from the book, paragraph from the journal, and if you have not read it, then tell them, I have to read it. Read it properly. Because it's, again I'm telling, it's not possible to read. The forensic medicine has 10 books. You have read one or two books, and it is from the another book, and it is accepted that you are not read, it's not seen at all. So accept it, I will read it. Don't comment vaguely, at first read it. Is that book is standard? Is that journal is standard? So like that, after reading, then and then only give your comment. Then professional secrecy. You are going to learn all this professional secrecy in a medical jurisprudence. But timing, I'm telling, what is professional secrecy? Professional secrecy is that during the examination, during your history taking, during your examination, you knows some secrets of the patient. And as a next to God, as a noble profession, you have to keep secrets to yourself only. Don't divulge it. Don't tell your friends. Don't make it as a gossip point. So that must be taken, and it's your duty, that professional secrecy, that all the secrets which are known to you during the history or examination, you have to keep it secret. That is professional secrecy. But there are some privileges known as privileged communication. There are some circumstances where you have to tell the secrets of the patient. And one of the circumstances is court, order by the court. If the court is ordered that the you have to tell the secrets, then you have to tell that secret or divulge that secret to the court, not in a public. So the professional secrecy can be divulged by court order. So these are the things you have to follow. You should be well dressed. You should look like next to God, well dressed, formal dress, decent dress, then well shaved. All these things must be, because they are taking you as a next to God. And another important thing, that whenever you go, the court always give preference to your witness, that doctor sahab aaye hai, unko patient hai, unko jana hai, jaldi mein hai. So they always do, you take your witness first, give you preference. That also the honor is given by court to you. So that's the thing. And we also have to give respect to court. Be confident. Again, I'm repeating, well converse with the study that case. Be confident. Should not fumble. Should not use scientific jargons. Be well dressed, decent dressed, formal dressed, stand erect, answer slowly, steadily, loudly, answer straightly, not to twist the words. Should not go beyond the knowledge. If the lawyer has given some book paragraph or the journal paragraph, first read and then only comment. And you know what is professional secrecy? That is, the secret must be kept to you only. Don't divulge to the public. Don't make it as a public issue. But in a certain circumstance, known as a privileged communication, by court order, you have to divulge the secret, and that is known as the professional secrecy. That's all about the court procedure. So what we all learned in a court procedure, I will take the revision, that in a first my lecture, I have taken about the different basic things. What is criminal procedure code? What is Indian Penal Code? What is civil procedure code? What is Indian Evidence Act? Different types of the inquest. Two inquests in India only. Again, I'm repeating, police and magistrate inquest. All over world, four: police, magistrate, coroners, medical examiners system. Which is best? Medical exam system of inquiry. Offenses, cognizable, non-cognizable. Cases, cognizable, non-cognizable. Warrant case, summons case, police case, complaint case, and different civil cases. Court, Supreme Court, High Court, Session Court, Chief Judicial Magistrate Court, Judicial Magistrate, First Class, Second Class Judicial Magistrate, Court of Juveniles, Special Judicial Courts. What are types of evidence? Oral, documentary, types, primary, secondary, material, direct, indirect, circumstantial, hearsay, prima facie, proved, disproved, not proved. What are the important, what is corpus delicti? Is the body finding on which your appearance will suggest that some illegal act has occurred relating to the death of a person? That is corpus delicti. Important documentary evidence. What is medical certificate, medical legal reports? What is the difference between medical certificate, medical legal reports? Certificate is always given on a request of patient, while reports are given on a request of authority. Certificate of only one page, while medical legal reports consist of the three parts: first, general information; second, signs, symptoms, your observation; and third part is that your opinion. And dying declaration, dying deposition, which is superior? Dying deposition. Why? Magistrate is present. Second, accused or his lawyer may present. It should be taken on an oath, and doctor has to give the certificate in both cases. That is, the person is in a compos mentis. Then court procedure. What is summons? Is the document compelling a person to attend a court at date, particular day, time, place. How, if two summons are there, how these summons in duplicate, where it should be issued. You have to give the preference to all I have taken, and many times short note has came on summons. What is conduct money? It is the fee expenses attending in a court. Then what is examination in chief? Then what is cross examination? What are leading question? Leading question is a question where the answer is itself in a question or answer is of yes or no type. Then what is cross examination, re examination, question by judge, and release of witness from the court? What are the precaution as a doctor in a witness box has to take? I have told that well concerned, be confident, should not fumble, do not use scientific jargons. Be well dressed, decent dressed, stand erect, answer slowly, steadily, loudly, answer straightly, not to twist, should not go beyond the knowledge, caution, paragraph from book, journal, and professional secrecy divulged due to the court order. Again, thank you very much for your patience. I have covered this first chapter. I think I have cleared your concept, basic concept related to the forensic medicine. Next, I will come with another chapter, that is the identity. Thank you very much.